for tomorrow.
All right.
Yeah. So good morning, everyone. Kalimera. It is quite Greek, as I mentioned beforehand, and I just realized that my presentation is at the end, so let me just take it to the beginning and share my screen. So actually, I guess you will see it in a moment or two. This presentation began with the best of the omens, and it was about to prove how Murphy, with his first law, was to be proved correct. Whatever can be wrong will be wrong. And his second law, that if something went wrong, don't be relaxed, it can go worse. So I began expecting that a glorious series of events would take place in Greece as we approach the 200 years of the Greek Revolution, but nothing went okay. So I actually came out without having anything to show. But let me begin. I think it's 15 minutes, isn't it? More or less. Okay, 200 years ago, one more rebellion against the Ottoman Empire broke in the city of Iasi in Romania, which is our virtual landlord. How is it called? Anyway, though it didn't manage to overturn the empire, it is considered as the first act in the Greek Revolution that followed a few weeks later and was the first successful revolution against the empire at that time. Being a child of its time, the Greek Revolution was one of the first of the age of nationalism. As the revolution was the constituting event of modern Greek state, it soon became part of national myths, which extended back to the 400 years of slavery, while the roots went as back as ancient Greece, whatever is meant by this. For the rest of the 19th and part of the 20th century, the myth has been constantly amended. The supposed date of the revolution in Peloponnese became a national commemoration date as early as 1838. The establishment of a national commemoration day and the relevant rituals has been fundamental in the rooting and development of modern national states worldwide. While it incorporated elements of the rituals established centuries earlier by the monarchies and the empires, for example, parades, decoration of public buildings with flags and emblems, participation to special religious ceremonies to support the connection between nation and its god, etc. The importance of such rituals for promoting a more or less invented tradition, establishing the right of a nation to have its own state, has been emphasized in the invention of tradition by Hobsbawm and Ranger, and taken further in the works of several authors during the last three decades. The yearly repetition of such rituals makes them ideal for semiotic analysis, as well as for the analysis of discourses and ideologies related to nation building and nation sustenance. I would just remind of the seminal work by Katz and Dayan, Media Events. They call media events the live broadcasts of great events that transform individuated and stratified masses into the communitas of whole societies, riveting them not just to programs in general, but to the very same broadcast, transporting them not just elsewhere, but to the center. And they explain that they refer to the live broadcasts of ceremonial occasions that are pre-planned and well advertised. Within the cyclical repetition of such events, some anniversaries acquire a special status. It is the jubilees that provide the opportunity for increased ceremonial, ritual, and symbolic content, as well as for heightened inspiration of the state as it claims to be baptized once again into the fountain of nations' will. They also provide an opportunity for renegotiating the content and explanations of events past, preparing and organizing the events still to come, legitimizing certain aspirations over others. This is what one may call the ideological management or ideological manipulation of the past. So I learned quite a few new words, like the Golden Jubilee of the revolution in 1871. It means 50 years from some event. It took place amidst grave conditions in Greece. An unsuccessful rebellion in Crete against the Ottoman Empire. Then there was the killing of English and Italian diplomats kept hostages by bandits a few weeks before the Jubilee. And a long-term civil unrest. A year earlier, an attempt was made for a contest for the erection of a monument and a pantheon with statues of the heroes in front of the University of Athens, both symbols of the national unity, despite the fact that Greece was a small part of what was considered as the proper geographical territory of the nation. Just to mention that both the monument and the pantheon would take several years to complete. Actually, the monument was somehow completed, I think, for the 100th, for the centenary, as it is called. So, the celebration was organized in conjunction with the recovery of the bones of Patriarch Gregorius V from Odessa and their ceremonial transfer and burial in the Athens Cathedral. Gregorius actually opposed the revolution and excommunicated the revolutionaries, but eventually was hung and his dead body was desecrated. With the ritual burial at the cathedral, he was incorporated into the pantheon of the revolution, allowing for the definitive marriage between the state and the church, as it was the then King George who was becoming somehow the heir of his pleuronomia. Anyway, I think you know more Greek than me. So then the ceremonial, the centennial celebration of the revolution was postponed until 1930 because of the war between Greece and Turkey in Asia Minor, which ended with a disaster for Greeks the next year. 9 years later, the results of that disaster were still evident in national life, as well as political instability. According to some researchers, the stake was that the celebration would signal the effort for development in the interior, as well as for peaceful coexistence with the neighboring countries and mostly with Turkey. The sesquicentennial celebration, as I found it is called, which means the celebration of 150 years, took place in 1971 amidst the rule of a military dictatorship. They attempted to provide a religious aura to their rule, mostly through the organization of several celebrations throughout the year, all over the national territory, with an emphasis to religious practices, followed by parades and representation of events that took place during the revolution in a local or a national level. Such an organization was one more attempt towards promoting the central mottos of the dictators being both motherland, religion, and family, one of them, and the second, Greek of Greeks and Christians and Orthodox. In any case, such a ceremonial structure was constant throughout the 7 years of their rule, with kitsch spectacles glorifying the regime. Thus, the fourth Jubilee celebration, that of the bicentennial, was expected to distance itself from the sinister events surrounding the previous ones. As early as 2012, the then Prime Minister Antonis Samaras promised that his newly elected government would lead the country out of the sovereign debt crisis to economic and social development in order to proudly celebrate the bicentennial. Officially, the crisis ended in 2018, and the next year, the newly elected government designated a prestigious committee to oversee the preparations and organize the celebration. Yan Angelopoulou Daskalaki was appointed as chair of the committee, who had a reputation as the chair of Athens 2004 Olympics. She was soon to speak about deconstructing national myths and restoring national truth, since all that is true is national, according to a national poet, Dionysios Solomos. On the inaugural meeting of the committee, Prime Minister Mitsotakis insisted that it is worthy to approach the biennial of the revolution in several ways, bicentennial actually, in the strong light of historical experience, in the wise light of its teaching, but also with its positive projection in the future as a compass. It is an opportunity for a bold account, but also a lively reflection. Reflection and investment of our values with a new meaning, leading ultimately to national self-understanding. It is, after all, a reacquaintance with our collective self, which will offer an opportunity to Greece for internal reorganization and for reestablishing itself with its modern identity in Europe and the whole world. You can see the front page of a newspaper magazine, which was never went into circulation because an outcry in social media the day before its circulation. It presents the Prime Minister and Yan Angelopoulou Daskalaki as heroes of the revolution, along with certain leaders of the European Union and the countries like France and the United Kingdom and Cyprus, as well as Vladimir Putin and Tayyip Recep and Erdogan as in attire of the era, as if they are incorporating in modern times the War of Independence. Actually, one could spend the whole of the discussion searching the relationships between the persons depicted here, but I would like to go on and give you a few more indications of important signs that were used at that time. Such a rhetoric, like the one presented by Prime Minister, was repeated by the chair of the committee as well as other members, and gave the signal not only for the deconstruction of national myths, which after all was underway for at least two decades already, but also for a challenge to accepted science of the nation. As expected, such an idea was not well accepted by the general public. The construction sounds suspect when initiated by the hegemonic discourse and its bearers. Therefore, the novel truth, which sometimes looks like an invented tradition as well, was met with criticism by its audiences and overt hostility in social media, not only by the far-right audiences. The first step in this direction was made with the design of the logo and its presentation about a year before the actual celebration. It is just 50 seconds, so I will show it to you. Almost at the moment, this presentation was online. A discussion and criticism came to the fore exactly about the science of the nation and the meaning of the bicentennial of the revolution. It was about the colors used and also about the meaning of such a ribbon, which was unfamiliar to its audience. Actually, for most of its part, it was resembling to nothing. It had three darker stripes and two lighter ones, which was never reminding or reminiscent of the stripes of the Greek flag. And people were soon to find out that it was more like a ribbon in the Russian and Soviet period, a stripe, a ribbon about a medal of St. George, I think. So things became complex enough, and the company that produced the design had to defend their ideas publicly after this decry. Presenting the underlying ideas, they had to adopt traditional signs, thus abandoning the deconstructioning myth, the myth that they were about to deconstruct certainties and myths of long held by the Greek publics. So they have shown how this ribbon was welcoming the Greek history by inserting photos. In some way, telling again the same story, how the continuity of the Greek history has led to the present. And they made a new challenge by using Yannis Antetokounmpo as the final, as the culmination of Greek history, thus challenging the far-right audiences to once again challenge the idea of the presentation, since Yannis is not as white as they think about themselves. And they had all the things to the right, which are very good for a designer, but are not easy to be understood by a general audience. And then the pandemic came, and everything went wrong. Actually, a few days before the culmination of the celebration, the 25th of March, a series of local celebrations were held, because actually the revolution started two or three days earlier in some other places. So the head of the committee went to these places to attend the celebrations, wearing a kind of post-modernist attire, combining traditional forms as well as modern ones, and holding this little bag, which was very much discussed and made fun of, since it was postmodernist reconstruction of several signs and mostly of the national dress of thought to be used by the warriors 200 years ago. Actually, they wore something like that, but this is much more prestigious and official. And anyway, it is worn by the special troops. And I think I'm going over my time, so I will be a bit faster. So it combines and condenses the whole of the of this dress into a very small bag, a pouch. And then came the most important private cultural institution holding a museum since the age of Venizelos, so almost a century, promoting a charm, reading Health Orgasm Revolution as a wish for this year, which also made the an outcry, caused an outcry. I had prepared this small diagram with all the pictures, the images used by the organizing committee on Instagram, and it shows that a very small part of it, if you can see my cursor, it is down here, was about the events or famous personalities of the revolution and of the Greek past in general, while all the rest present the activity of the committee and mostly of its chair. After all, jubilees are the worst time to replace invented traditions with new ones, with new invented traditions. And just thank you for this.
Thank you, Professor Scarpellos. It was a very interesting and useful presentation. I think
not
that,
much semiotic, though.
It doesn't
as
matter.
As Massimo Leone mentioned yesterday.
Okay. Part of semiotics, those kind of representations. So it's similar. So if we can move on, my turn. Okay. Can you see my PowerPoint presentation?
Not actually.
It is loading.
No, it's okay.
Thank you. Have to. Excellent. Okay. My paper has to be about nonverbal communication in television episodes, films. I have to make. A semiotic approach to MacGyver series. Let's start. Actually, this work began with the main question as posed by Metz to understand how the film is understood. And as also Coconi studies in his paper, Metz claims that the semiotics of cinema be conceived as either as a semiotics of connotation or as a semiotics of denotation. The study of connotation brings us closer to the notion of the cinema as an art, the seventh art. Monaco supports that the cinema is an art and a medium of extensions and indexes. Much of this meaning comes not from what we see or hear, but from what we don't see, or more accurately, from an ongoing process of comparison of what we see with what we don't see. The subject of this paper is the importance of visual science in general, and especially about the icon, index, and symbol, and especially the indexes, together with aesthetic factors in the process of the filmic semiosis. I am going to study a combination of semiotic modes with aesthetic factors to, in order to produce the appropriate meaning in films and in television films, and also to study the connotative meanings in non-verbal communication process during the process of audiovisual discourse and semiosis. My topic is MacGyver series, the original one. MacGyver is an American action-adventure television series created by Lee David Lotoff and starring by Peter Dean Anderson as the title character. Actually, MacGyver is not an ordinary secret agent. He never carries a gun and he fights for justice just using his intelligence. The series follows the adventures of Angus MacGyver, a secret agent armed with remarkable scientific resourcefulness and knowledge about physics and chemistry to solve almost any problem out in the field using the everyday items at his hand. The show ran for seven reasons on ABC in the United States from 1985 to 1992. There are a large number of episodes, and also the series have won a list of awards. Moving on the theoretical framework, I'm going to use the categorization of pairs about icon, symbol, and index, and also the aesthetic factors as Kokonis and Zettel have supported. Kokonis states about aesthetics that we refer to the special rules and principles that apply to the composition of a visual image in all means of culture, and especially about vectors, a kind of aesthetic factors. Zettel says that vectors have an indicative ability since their main function is to direct the gaze from one point to another. Specifically for a graphic vector, Zettel argues that is created by a stationary element that guides our eyes in a certain direction. It is driven by the principle of continuity. The direction of a graphic vector is ambiguous, however. About index vectors, index vector is created by something that points unquestionably in a specific direction. Examples are arrows or people pointing or looking in a particular direction. Index vectors also include still photographs or runners or somebody riding a motorcycle, for example. And Kokonis also says that index vectors have a greater potential as they are created when a visual element undoubtedly points in a certain direction. Human face looking in a certain direction represents an index vector. And the last one kind of vectors and the context of aesthetic factors is a motion vector, which is created by an object that is actually moving or seen as a moving screen. So a motion vector cannot be illustrated with a picture in a book. Kokonis have the same opinion. Motion vectors have an even greater potential to draw attention to the viewer's perception, since anything that moves or appears to move is a direct call of attraction. Also, field forces is a factor. The composition of an image within a frame where either horizontal or vertical lines or a combination of the two are named field forces. We see that when we have the horizontal directions, the image effect to the viewer is a feeling of low energy, feeling of calmness, stability, and quiet. Settle argues that the horizontal lines offer normalcy, calm, tranquility, and rest. Also, Settle claims that the vertical line seems to be more dynamic, powerful, and exciting than the horizontal ones. And also, Kokonich supports the predominance of vertical directions within the frame because it creates a feeling of high visual energy, giving the depicted character strength, prestige, power, formality, and so on. These are some examples about horizontal lines. This one and the vertical ones. About the volume duality, Zettel says that the volume duality is divided to positive and negative volume. Positive volume has substance, it can be touched and has a clearly described mass. Positive volumes include such objects as cars, desks, chairs, trees, or whatever. And the negative volume is empty, is an empty space that is somehow delineated by positive volumes. The interior of a room, for example, is a negative volume because it's clearly described by the positive volumes of the walls, ceiling, the floor, or any object inside there. This is an example of positive and negative volume together. Let's say that the positive volume are sun, the trees, the plants, and described by the air that remains in the. And also we have the camera viewpoint, which is very interesting about the psychological impact it has. Actually, Zettel says that when the point of view is from above, an object appears to be less powerful than when the point of view is from below. And when an object is taken from below, from a position below the eye level, then the object appears to be dynamic and powerful. Some examples. The first one is the second one picture is an example from a camera viewpoint from above in order to see the difference, in order to see how it looks like. And we can move on the concept of analysis. Actually, this is an example about all those factors I have spoken about. First, we have the scene from the episode "The Golden Triangle." We see and we can look an officer that goes next to MacGyver near to. The protagonist, and MacGyver is informed of the task assigned to him. While the protagonist is on a beach and relaxes, suddenly an officer comes to announce him his duty. When the director decides to show us the officer. The camera viewpoint is from below, from MacGyver's point of view. So we also embrace his position. It's like entering his role. The camera does not show the officer's face from the beginning, except for his end value here. Also, the officer's body has filled the frame with a positive volume and only little negative volume remains, which is the air here. This situation creates a state of stress and anxiety to the audience because they wonder who is there, and MacGyver may feel under pressure, and the viewer should feel this emotional situation. For this reason, the director of popular
Thomas, I think you have to resume the recording.
Yes, what stop? Is it okay now?
Yeah.
Okay, now we can see the next scene. MacGyver has taken a cuff with him and opens. So we see that the camera places the viewer in the forest. The shot comes from the protagonist's eye level and the very position of the hero. It is a sub. The director puts the audience in the character's visual position and in the difficult position he finds himself going through the forest. The very graphic and the positive volume, the air, for example, fills a frame and creates a suffering environment for both hero and the viewer. This is the next scene. MacGyver has spotted by the bad guys of this episode. The camera slowly focuses with a close up on the face of the hero to convey the meaning to us that he's suffering, and we understand this from the expressions. The director does not tell us that it's hot outside, but we can mention his face, MacGyver's face. And for example, for the indexicality of heat, the director chooses the representation of the sun as an index of heat without verbal reference to the temperature degrees. He achieves that with aesthetic means, with a little sweat on MacGyver's face, with his open mouth looking for oxygen, and the sun's warm colors, yellow and orange, for example. But saying anything verbally uses all these elements to make the shot more aesthetically rich, in order to transfer us from the denotation to the connotation, in order to communicate the message he wants, that the hero suffers from the heat, the high temperature. Here we can see the protagonist standing on a high rock and talking to his enemy, to Wang, with body position here, which reflects the sentence. The MacGyver's position in this space is high in a vertical direction towards Wang. The camera viewpoint is from below, and the frame is filled with enough graphic volume. As we can see, all the structural elements of the image, forms and graphic indexes and volumes, end to the show that the point of maximum interest is MacGyver, vertical and diagonal in the frame. This position gives to the protagonist power, authority, and strength. MacGyver looks at his enemy from above, while Trunk sees him from below. And that becomes a clear psychological impact. Makes Trunk feel less powerless, embarrassed and less important. It looks like his enemy is the inferior and MacGyver is the superior. Frank throw him off, pulls the gun and shoots him without find a target. This is the end of this episode. The bad parts of the story have been defeated. The villagers have realized that what happened, and everyone surrounds MacGyver as their hero. The camera viewpoint is from above so that the audience can clearly see Ruan is looking at MacGyver, and we understand that from the glasses, from their gaze, and also from the direction of their shoes. All the vectors and graphic indexes and indexical forms are oriented towards MacGyver. This attitude gives to the protagonists a lot of value. There is also the motion index from the helicopter propeller that rotates slowly. In one hand, the normal flow that follows because the helicopter landed a long time ago. And also it may indicate that the story, the adventure has come to an end. The next example is a shot I would like to focus to this one, this episode named Gold Rush, and there are some shots that change each other from objective to subjective shot and vice versa, so that the viewer can feel what the protagonists feel while they are riding the snowboard. The speed that with the snowboard runs in a high enough is high enough for the viewer to feel the danger that the protagonists are in. Okay, there's a problem here. Okay, we have to move on. I think that we have seen there are many close-ups to those faces, to the entire screen. This frequent change of the shots adds an intensity you can see this high stress on MacGyver's face because the time is running out, and consequently the frames anchor the viewer gaze, and also the music plays a fundamental role in intensity escalation. I think that I've spoken too much. So, on the remarks. I have to conclude that the image and the frames in cinema and television series aims to create a specific aesthetic effect in order to achieve connotation. A specific way of expression and aesthetic factors need to be considered in creating content. Connotation is a result of human intervention in the process, in the filmic process. For example, the camera distance, the camera angle, the focus, the lighting effects. The messages can be transmitted through verbal and non-verbal signs. The truth is that the cinema and the television firstly choose the image which is more immediate. Also, the television uses the same methods as film to connote meaning, such as camera angle, lighting, and background music. And we can say that there's a kind of communication between the director and the audience through visual signs in order to TV film become more understandable. Those are my references, and I apologize for the problems. Finished. Can now move on to the next presentation by Andrew Mark Creighton, The Implosion of Leisure Labor Within Fan Fiction Transmedial Worlds.
Yes, hello. Thank you, Thomas. I will just set up my screen. And yes, my name is Andrew Mark Creighton. I'm a PhD student from the semiotics department at the University of Tartu. I will be discussing how fan fiction online communities make use of internet structures and transmedia worlds to implode labor and leisure, to exploit members within these communities. And my justifications for presenting this mainly retains to current fan fiction literature largely being utopian. So my intent here is not to negate this past literature, but to try to even it out. So I'll be using three perspectives here. The first is McDonaldization. It is a contemporization of Max Weber's form of rationalization. It is largely associated with American sociologist George Ritzer. And so here, McDonaldization relates to a means to ends goal achievement structured by strict regulations. And McDonaldized systems tend to experience increasing levels of efficiency, predictability, calculability, and control. And within these systems, there is often a mechanism that allows for this increasing efficiency, predictability, and so on. And this is implosion, which is a concept that Ritzer draws from Jean Baudrillard. And it refers to the erosion of borders between meanings. And perhaps the most obvious example of this is a smartphone, and that it is, regarding function at least, it is an erosion of borders between, say, a camera, computer, phone, calculator, and so on. However, McDonaldization, and this is a term George Ritzer takes from Weber as well, tends to result in irrational rationalities, things such as ecological destruction, alienation, and anomie. And this brings me to the second perspective that I will be considering, and this is Stepan Mestrovich's post-emotionalism. And this, in a sense, and I'm simplifying here quite a bit, but it can be considered a type of anomie, or at least a theorization of anomie and alienation as a wider sociological phenomenon. And so here, Stepan Mestrovich is interested in the nullification of emotions, which you can see is this erosion of meanings regarding emotions and the traditional objects of intent, I guess you could say. And so here what I mean is emotions that traditionally are strong action-causing emotions tend not to be associated within post-emotional societies, tend not to be associated with events that require these emotions to create changes in actions. Instead, they tend to be socialized towards relatively inconsequential things. But perhaps more importantly, within these societies, there tends to be a loss of emotional community and cohesion. And Stepan Meshkovic refers to this as a fracturing of a collective effervescence, like here, of course, drawing from Emil Durkheim. And according to Meshkovic, this tends to create unstable, transient communities, which in turn creates a desire for this community, for this emotional effervescence. However, for many individuals, they are not able to achieve this. So this creates a further sense of insecurity, further desire for community, and it creates a sort of vicious circle, so to say. And of course, it is important to remember that these happen in degrees. So not only going by a society to society basis, but within society. So some individuals will be much more affected or immersed within these sorts of structures than others. And perhaps I will get to this after the end. And so the third perspective I'll be looking at is convergence culture. And of course, transmedia worlds is an important part of this. And so it's largely associated with the works of Henry Jenkins. And convergence culture takes consideration of a collective intelligence, participation, sorry for the spelling, culture. And here you can see this implosion of roles where traditionally consumers, producers, audience, performer, these roles have started to become converged as the perspective discusses. And you also tend to see these strong emotional commitments to fandoms, communities, and products associated with these fandoms. And while, again, I do not mean to shine these communities in a bad light, such emotional commitments to such types of communities tends to be somewhat, well, the emotions, of course, are quite strong, and these social bonds are there. They tend not to be as stable as you would tend to see in the more traditional community. So you can see here, this perspective quite easily relates to both Ritzer's McDonaldization and Meshkovic's post-emotionalism. But regarding transmedia worlds, you can also see this implosion of technology where fiction begins to be seen not only through one form of medium or media, and they also tend to have their own moral, geographical, and historical context. Of course, it is fictional, though perhaps drawn from real world events. It is largely fictional, but it also feeds into the strong emotional commitment and identity creation. So my intentions here, as I discussed earlier, is not to negate this earlier literature on fan fiction communities, but to present a possible perspective that will allow for a more critical understanding of fan fiction. So here, I'm really just intending to exemplify these theories as possible means to understand this aspect better. And to do this, I have largely drawn from fan fiction literature, and I've used these Harry Fan Potter fanfiction.com website, which tends to be mentioned quite a bit in the literature, to try and confirm and also analyze this fan fiction literature from confirm this literature. And so I largely look for technological, social, and communicative structures and processes within these communities through the literature and the websites. And I came up with some findings or examples. And regarding technology, computers, smartphones, websites, interfaces on the website, search bars, advertisements, and online stores all played quite an important role within these place communities. And these communities also tended to be transient, again, structured under very limited but specific goals and function, which was generally writing fan fiction, discussing discussing the fandom and the franchise. And so yes, so I did not necessarily, again, see this strong sort of pre-post emotional community within these communities. But perhaps more importantly, these communities tended to have expressed themselves more emotively, where strong emotions were favored over more analytical comments and discussions. Many commenters would reply to a story by discussing how it's made them feel, as opposed to critiquing structure of the story and so on. And also positive emotions tended to be favored over negative emotions. And if negative emotions were expressed, they were generally negated and contextualized to the point where it was very nullified. But also individuals who did express very explicit, strong negative emotions tended to experience a lot of repercussions from individuals within these communities. And also you can see again this transmedial aspect where many of the fiction was not only from, say, regarding Harry Potter, the books and films, but also video games. And these sites tended to produce quite a large amount of fiction. So when theory is applied, you can see these websites, search bars, computers, etc. They're very McDonaldized access to these communities and the products, and they allow for this increased production of these pages. So in a sense, publication is really just done on your computer. You can write it quite quickly. You can publish it. Others can read it within relatively short time from perhaps anywhere in the world. And yes, these communities are strongly emotionally invested in these fictional worlds. And especially regarding this ethos, those said communities are not immersive enough to create with Meshevich was talking about this missing collective effervescence. So this in turn may create, again, this community cycle, which creates a continuous need to be within the community. And in order to be effective member in the community, you must continuously produce fiction. And so the presence of these online stores and advertisements could be argued to implode labor with leisure here, where the emotional needs for the community is being exploited for finance and production. And when you consider this cycle, it again seems to reinforce this, that perhaps these communities' emotional needs are being exploited for this more financial aspect. So concluding, McDonaldized internet technologies allow for easy access and production in fan fiction communities. However, the unstable nature of these communities does not allow for strong community bonds, possibly creating a continuous desire for community that operates largely emotively and retains a strong emotional connection to a fiction franchise. These emotions and desires for the community may be used to exploit fan fiction communities when the production and interactions with these communities is monetized. Consequently, this desire for socialization and creative production begin being commodified can be understood as an implosion of labor and leisure. And however, as I've been, I hope I made this clear, it is very much an exemplification of the theory, forgive me. So there is quite a lot of further research here when I think we should be focusing on to what degree this is happening within communities, because while the theoretical framework is there, it is quite dependent on whether how influential this framework is upon members of these communities. And so we can ask, is this actually a social problem? Who is this most vulnerable to? And for instance, as I've been saying, isolated people may have a more vulnerability to these types of emotional needs and manipulation, as they tend not to have a primary group to instill community and reinforce their emotional needs in everyday life. And but ultimately, yes, to present this framework further, more quantitative and qualitative research is needed. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Andrew, for the presentation. And now we can move on to Eleni Alexandri, semiotic analysis of K-pop. Hello.
Hopefully you can see my screen.
Of course, yes.
Okay, so hello everyone. Saluti, salutari din Estonia. My name is Eleni Alexandri and I'm a freshly graduate student of semiotics at the University of Tartu. And today I'm going to present you my work and research on K-pop music. The presentation is partially based on my paper, The Korean Wave as a Form of Self-Description, and my MA thesis that is going to be published very soon, titled A Semiotic Analysis of K-pop, The Making of BTS Universe. So hopefully by the end of this presentation, I will have managed to demonstrate how important and rich as a topic is K-pop, how interesting it is for an analyst or research to deal with this material, and how many different opportunities it provides for multiple approaches. And to give you an outline of the presentation, I'm going to briefly talk about the history of K-pop in order to continue to its functionality as a form of self-description through intertextuality. And then on the second part, I'm going to talk about the findings and results of my thesis, exploring and analyzing the transmedial nature of BTS and BTS Universe franchise. So to start off, K-pop is part of Hallyu. Hallyu in English is the Korean wave, and it's a soft power strategy of South Korea of exporting culture. In Hallyu, we don't only have K-pop, which is Korean popular music, but we also have K-drama series, films, computer software and video games, even stock trading, operational systems, and e-government. So with Hallyu, Korean economy flourished, especially during the last decades. And also it has been observed an increase of income tourism, but the most important contribution of Hallyu to Korea was the opportunity to re-establish its identity and reintroduce itself to the rest of the world as a completely developed country and an economically and culturally force to be reckoned with. So understanding the impact of Korean wave and particularly K-pop on the Korean society, but also the rest of the world, made it clear that K-pop is much more than just the music genre. However, in order to understand Korean music, we have to understand its influences as well as it comes from. So the birth of the music genre dates back in the early 90s, and there are three main factors of the creation, contributing to the creation of K-pop. First one is Lee Soo-man, who essentially is the person that came up with the idea that K-pop and Korean music can be the country's next big export. Second reason is the Asian financial crisis, because it came at the worst possible time for Korea. After so many wars and occupations, dynasties, dictatorships, misfortunes, and a civil war that divided the peninsula in half, the Asian financial crisis of 90s could be the final blow. And that was exactly the time that the government realized the potentials of Lee Soo-man idea, the envision of exporting culture, and they invested in K-pop and Hallyu. And as it turns out, it was the wise decision. And the third factor is the boy band Seo Taijian Boys, that for many analysts and music experts, they are the fathers of K-pop. So one more thing that is very important about K-pop, but also Korean society, is the influence of different cultures that impacted Korea. Because of many occupations and because of the American troops that stayed in South Korea after the World War II, Korean society has been impacted in many different levels, as well as music, by all these different cultures. And because of their characteristic of being very adaptable and flexible and acceptive, they managed to incorporate these influences and merge them together with their own traditional elements and create this amalgamation. Which one example would be K-pop, but it's not the only one. Hyundai is another great example of how they combine traditional elements with foreign influences. So this acceptability and approach of merging together these different elements was exactly what they took advantage of when they were creating K-pop. K-pop is a mixture of different music genres, different music styles, different aesthetics. And soon enough, they realized that apart from a great economical aid, it can also give them the opportunity of national branding or self-description. So self-description, according to Professor Torup, is the most universal feature of any culture. And it's the capability of a dialogue with the self and with others that helps to create a self-model of culture, a self-image. So during this process and in order to achieve this self-description through K-pop music, they used intertextual elements. And there are three different levels of intertextuality in K-pop. According to my research, the first was to create a channel of communication between Korea and the rest of the world. They have to set a common code, and by implementing references of global pop culture, mostly American, into their music videos and aesthetics, but also kinesiology, choreographies, music and lyrics, even the names of the bands and solo artists, they managed to say to the rest of the world that, you know what, we're not that different. We share many common elements. And thus they became more, the global audience became more familiar with K-pop. And this gave paved the way for the next step, the second level of intertextuality. So when they achieved to establish this communicative channel, they started implementing traditional Korean elements to the music videos. So now we see Korean artists and Korean idols wearing traditional clothes, hanboks, and gats, traditional clothes. We can hear in the music traditional instruments and music styles like bansori, samulnori, pongjak, and we can even observe the implementation and incorporation of Korean arts, aesthetics, even architecture and national symbols that are now present in their music videos. However, this was not the last step for K-pop, because the last level of intersexuality was after their successful communication with the culture itself. So following the five types of communication presented by Lotman, we are reaching the fifth stage, the communication of the text with a cultural context. And through this process, K-pop established its position within the cultural sphere and went through the process of self-recording. So now K-pop is the one that is being the element of intertextuality, and K-pop is referenced by other texts and other productions. And I have plenty of examples to show you, but the most prominent one, and the one that this picture that you see is taken from, is from League of Legends online MOBA game by Riot Company. In 2018, they created a whole series of skins for the characters that they resemble the styling and accessories of K-pop idols. And this series of skins was accompanied by an original song performed by a completely fictional and virtual K-pop group created by Riot as a tribute to K-pop, the music genre that is now dominating the world. And this music video also, this song also was accompanied by a music video that, apart from following the structure of K-pop music videos and the aesthetics, also had intertextual references to mythologies and national symbols. So it was a very inclusive and plural. And we see how now K-pop has won this bet and won this intertextual implementation. However, this was part of the success, because after establishing a communicative channel, communication channel with the rest of the world, now we have K-pop industry has to maintain the attention of the people, of the international audience. And this is why we see lately that K-pop industry is implementing transmedial storytelling in a way to offer a more holistic experience to the audience and maintain their attention. And in order to examine not only the intertextual elements, but also the transmedial storytelling, I could not find a more appropriate example than BTS. BTS, or Bangtan Sonyeondan, is the best and more successful band of their generation, but also maybe in K-pop in general. They have plenty of awards and accomplishments. They are a great asset for Korean economy. They have a huge net worth. And lately they are being constantly compared by many prestigious sources to music legends as Beatles and Metallica. So my idea behind my thesis and my research, now we're moving to the second topic, was to discover this transmedial nature of BTS body of work and to understand how it is structured. I didn't want to take anything for granted. I didn't want to just acknowledge the transmediality of their body of work or just to accept the close borders of their franchise. I wanted to examine all the meaning-making mechanisms and to understand why, even though we can find references from 2013, the band's debut, why so many materials and references are left outside from the closed borders of their franchise. So in order to do that, I used as my main theoretical framework, Poetics of Expressiveness, an amazing theory by Alexander Zolkovsky and Yuri Seglov that I really urge you and prompt you to take a look. So the fundamental idea is that the text is a manifestation, or in other words, a derivation of its theme. And the theme acquires a voice, gets a voice by expressive devices. And this theory was originally made in order to analyze literature, but I managed to apply in order to analyze music videos. And indeed, I analyzed all music videos of BTS from 2013 until present day. And I managed to outline the artistic identity of BTS. What are the invariant themes and motives? What are the recurrent elements in their work? And in the end, what are the messages that the band wants to communicate with the world? Then my next step was to understand how all this information are being translated to extra material. Thus, we can speak about transmediality. So in transmediality, we have the materials that are being distributed to different media platforms, but each platform should add up to the already known stuff in order for everything, all the individual pieces to work in synergy. So in the end, the sum, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. So I wanted to treat music videos as a prototext in Popovich terms, and the extra materials, the different media platforms as metatexts. And through this analysis of translation, I realized, and this is also my contribution, that we cannot talk about a prototext. We cannot talk about a solid or original source, because not everything was translated from music videos to extra materials. It was not even that the translation was happening from the song or the lyrics to the extra materials. The original source was the main ideas, the message that the band wants to communicate with the world, the theme. So I came with the term proto-theme because it's the abstract idea that is being translated to everything else through a complicated process of intersemiotic translation with resemiotization in Iedema terms into the intersemiotic space. And the last part was to see why and how the franchise is built that way. Why, even though we can see that the themes are being translated into other materials, why the franchise is so closed. And through different combination of theories, mainly Jenkins and Gomez, but also the ethos, mythos, and topos by Klastrup and Tosca, I was able to realize, understand, justify, and explain and highlight exactly why the BTS franchise is structured in that way. Yes, there is an artistic identity, and yes, there is a message and a main theme in their body of work, but the franchise had to be limited. First of all, in order to be profitable and coherent, and the audience can follow it without feeling that there are some gaps, or they cannot understand something, or they need to spend so much time to follow, but also because if everything, every material from the debut until now is connected, the outcome would be that new people, new fans would feel excluded and discouraged from becoming a follower of the band or appreciate and give their own interpretation to their music and music videos. So at the end of the day, it was a very explanatory overview of the meaning-making mechanisms and the structure of the poetic world of BTS, but also the structure of their franchise and the strategies of the K-pop industry. And to conclude, I would like to talk about some future research that could happen. Based on my research, I see that there is a whole opportunity to study the new era of K-pop. We see now that with the success of the genre, and now that they are getting into the American market more and more, we see more English lyrics appearing. And a good idea would be to see how this is impacting the functionality of K-pop as a form of self-description, but also how it impacts the identities of the bands and solo artists. We could talk about the different variations of transmedia storytelling in other bands and see how the transmedial storytelling, it leaves the film industry, and it's being applied now in music industry as well in order to offer this holistic experience to the fans and to satisfy the demands of this audience with new needs in this new technological era. And lastly, can we talk about poetics of music videos, and can we achieve something like this? Because it would be something very interesting and something that might be hard and needs a lot of work, but it's something doable and it's something that can open new opportunities and dialogues. So this was everything for me. Thank you very much. Damsa hamnida, mulțumesc, sureta, ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ.
Thank you very much, Eleni, for your innovative research.
Thank you.
There is no much time left because of my phone.
No, no. It's... So, if anyone wants to contact me, my email address is here. I would be very happy to answer to any question.
Excellent. So we will have one or two quick questions in order to move on then the next keynote lecture by Christian Bakov.
I raised hand.
Hello.
Hi, I raised hand. Moderator, may I talk?
Yes.
Can I talk?
Yes, of course.
Thank you, thank you. You promote my country, Korea, and thank you very much. But it is not so very simple because Korea has a 5,000 years history. And this history is our identity. Because of K-pop, we lost many, many things. So once they have seven boys, and they are now they extended, they don't go to military service so far. So many, many things. And Korea, we had a complex as well because of historically. So we put so much money to UNESCO as well. So we want to have back our pride. So K-pop is not all. There, as you mentioned, Hallyu, Korean food, Korean dress, everything, okay? So you have to understand what is a negative effect from K-pop, because when they sing in English, I know, in America, can be also bad because we now it's anti-America, anti-Japan, many, many, many things happen. So please try to find also negative side and positive side, and then find your own way to analyze.
Of course, of course. Thank you so much for your comment.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think we have to disconnect from this panel to follow Jan Bankov to the next session. So thank you everyone for being with us today, and it was a pleasure to me. Thank you everyone.
Thank you so much.
Goodbye.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Have a nice day. Thank you for all the lectures.